Hey everyone, this is Robo Oso and Silver.
Hello.
And today we're going to be talking about ReZero's episode 23 with some background footage from Drunken Robot Pornography.
Very sexy.
So our first part is just something that we were both a little confused on, which was the whole blank letter aspect.
Yeah, as it happened when they brought up the blank letter thing, I was a little bit confused because I was just expecting Rom to be like, oh, he's coming in with those people who are affiliated with other factions, and he's turned on us, he's betrayed us. You know, she doesn't like him anyway, so she thinks, like, you know, she doesn't have a high opinion of him. But then when she mentions the letter, I was confused. I do remember him writing a letter, but he wrote a letter. It wouldn't be blank. And so, but he didn't really, they didn't discuss that point. He wasn't like, wait a minute, that I didn't do that. That's strange. Maybe it was intercepted or somebody magically erased it or whatever. So that was odd.
And see, I don't recall if this is the reality where he... Because I remember there was a time where he was studying how to at least read the language with Emilia, but I don't remember if he ever learned how to write it.
Well,
he,
if you do remember, he was practicing writing it too. He was doing all the repetitions
of
writing it.
I am assuming that it's... connect, you know, it's continuing from that aspect. So I think he did write something, and I was just expecting that whoever was delivering the letter was going to be killed and that they never received the letter. That's what I thought was going
to
happen.
And that might have happened, and it was replaced with a blank one to be confusing.
Yeah, but ultimately, you know, whatever that whole misunderstanding was, you know, that was cleared up actually pretty fast because Ram was immediately like, you know, okay with him again. And they were just, you know, on to just defending the village. So it didn't really have any huge conflict at all.
No, other than it was just kind of strange. But to back up a little bit before that, when he's in the hallucination, he gets out of it. It's established that he has potentially strong spirit affinity or something. And this was alluded to a little bit before when they did the testing of what type he was, and he was the rare type. I don't remember if it was darkness or black or whatever he was. So we're getting some kind of hints that he has latent abilities, latent talents, and that's kind of came full circle potentially at the end, but we'll get there later.
Yeah, and I've actually been waiting, you know, ever since he had been sparring with Wilhelm in the previous episodes and everything, I've just always been waiting for him to kind of practice honing his magic abilities and honing his spirit, you know, abilities, because, you know, eventually he probably will unleash, like, really powerful, like, spirit attacks, seemingly, because it seems like his ability to detect, like, you know, the witch and so forth is getting stronger and stronger. And now that he's hearing these comments from Julius about, oh, I guess, you know, you do have this, you know, this affinity with spirits, and he's talking about Puck and everything, I just feel like he is getting stronger. Maybe he doesn't realize it yet, but I would like him to actually kind of, like, I don't know, try to train a little more and just get stronger with his ability. Because he did try. At one point, he was trying to, like, use the technique. And he is kind of... he is getting better at manipulating it in a way where he can draw that scent out, you know, so that things can be drawn to him, like the whales, and attack him. So he is doing some of that. I just want him to do that a little more.
Yeah, but the only concern I have is that part of the uniqueness and interestingness of his character is that he's weak and that he's vulnerable and that he really has to rely on others for fighting and for strength most of the time. That was subverted slightly in this. Well, not quite. I guess he used a trap. But anyway, going kind of linearly through the episode, the next thing, and stop me if you had something earlier, but the next thing for me that I thought was odd was when Felis notices that guy is an undercover, you know, member of the witch cult, and he explodes, and then the next thing we see is Subaru waking up, and there's a huge battle, and the cultists are fighting everybody, that Felis and Julius are just kind of standing over him, and Felis being there makes sense, but Julius is standing there with his sword sheathed, and there's tons of people fighting all over the place, and people are getting, you know, there are villagers killed, and the soldiers are dying, and Julius, who's presumably, you know, one of the best fighters there, is just kind of standing there, waiting to talk to Subaru for him to wake up, which struck me as sort of the kind of thing that would happen in a video game. You know,
well, like, you know, Subaru is literally the center of this world.
Well,
it's
yeah,
how this world
yeah,
exists.
And it really felt like it. It was kind of odd to me because they're waiting for just Subaru to gain consciousness. Like, yeah, other things are happening, but Julius just doesn't care. And it just seemed, I don't think it was intentional, but it was just kind of odd.
Whenever he's unconscious, the world just literally stops.
Well,
no,
well,
I know that's not true.
Because,
but
it was
just
strange.
Funny.
Yeah, it was just odd.
It's just funny, yeah. It was a very video game, like, how long was he out? Maybe, like, a few seconds, but probably longer than that, since she had, like, a different outfit on and everything.
Yeah, because presumably her clothes burned off, but she then, like, healed her wounds and then put on a sack. Or he, it's a guy.
Or he, right.
Yeah. And then the little bit, when he comes back and he then taunts that female sin priest or whatever they're called, and
yeah, beetle.
Well, actually,
the female
before,
Beetlejuice, or
I don't think her. I think she, did she have a different name? I don't remember what her name was. But before that, he triggers his own death flag. Right? He
right.
says, you know, like, you know, Julius. Oh, I'll tell you later or something. Which is. He used to be very aware of death flags in the first bunch of episodes. When people would say something, he'd be like, oh no, or you know, he'd be thinking about it. So it's odd to see him do that. But then he mouths off to her, right? He pulls out the little Bible thing for the witch cult.
The gospel, yeah.
And, yeah, the gospel. And then he makes the comment about his brain trembling, which later when he gets taken over by Beetlejuice, it's that was kind of completed and it was, you know, ironic.
Hilarious.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I just want to say, though, in general, about the whole, like, Beetlejuice as a villain, I just think at this point, I mean, when we first were introduced by him, I thought he was a little too over the top for this world. Like, he just seemed really out of place with his, like, his energy and his constant, like, twisting of his head and being like, love, 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 love. Like, I just thought it was a bit much. So I'm just getting kind of, like, a little tired by this villain. Like, I want to move on and maybe see the other sins and stuff. I do like how he is a lot harder to kill than what we had anticipated. I was exactly like Subaru, I think, in the last episode, too, where being like, is he dead yet? Like, let's make sure he's dead, you know? And I knew he was going to come back still because
I'm disappointed that he came back. I think it's kind of dumb. I always hate enemies that are like, oh, they can just take someone over. It always feels a little bit dumb to me. It's like, just write a different villain. Like, don't have Beetlejuice keep coming back. Another thing, and I don't find him as annoying and out of place as you do. What I do find annoying and out of place is the fact that everyone is the same. The old man, the girl, Beetlejuice, all of them act the same way and say the same things.
Yeah,
it's like different actors interpreting the same role, but with the same director, so they all act the same. Can they act differently?
Well, I do like the fact that I do sort of like that aspect that they're all acting the same because he is like the same like entity or whatever he is.
Well, yeah, like if that literally is like, because I didn't take it that literally. If it literally is the same personality inhabiting all of their bodies simultaneously, then it does make complete sense. That's not what I thought of it as. I guess that's true.
That's
then,
what I
maybe.
Assumed it was. Yeah.
If that's true, then it does make sense. But I thought it was that they were. I guess that probably is what it's supposed to be. I just never took it that way. I took it like they were all brainwashed.
Yeah,
I took it like it was more like a cult.
He's possessing their
bodies.
No,
I think
at
you're
the
right.
End when he says like, "Oh, this is a great vessel." Like, this is the best vessel I'm in.
It's clearly established that he can take other bodies, but I didn't think that he was in all of them simultaneously. You know, I thought that maybe he was in one at a time. But I guess maybe he's all of them or something. So that would make their similar behavior make sense.
And I mean, like, you know, I usually like campy villains like that. The one thing I do like is how the woman had all those claw marks on her face, like the bloody, like, marks and stuff. The whole, like, mutilation aspect that they do with their, like, fanaticism, it's creepy, obviously, and it's kind of, like, interesting. But at the same time, it does kind of show me, like, okay, he's whatever he is, like an entity or spirit, or I'm not quite sure, but like he clearly doesn't really care that much about the vessel.
Yeah,
he kind of just destroy it.
Yeah, now it makes their self injury make a lot more sense if they're not really in control of themselves. If like, because yeah, if they're very disposable to him, then the self injury, the self harm makes a lot more sense.
And I mean, like, I actually didn't it's kind of obvious in retrospect, but I didn't really expect Subaru to be taken over. But now that he has, it's
Yeah, but before we get to that, the one thing I thought was, at the time when Subaru runs away, you know, he tells Julius to not help them, and then he wants to tell him something, and he's like, ah, forget it, and he provokes them and then runs away. I was thinking, like, where the hell is he going? Like, he better have a plan. He better have a plan, because he's running away from everyone who can help him.
It's like, oh, and is he going to be eaten by the mobbies? He's just going to throw himself.
Yeah, first I was thinking, like, are there still mobbies left? I thought they killed them all that time, or they killed a lot of them, but I guess there's still tons of them left.
Yeah, that was pretty awesome how they took out that girl.
Yeah, and so he removes the, you know, the Sims diamond thing, Sims jewel.
Sims crystal.
He removes the Sims crystal, so the barrier's broken. But what I thought was odd is that the way they did the direction was that, like, he saw it and then had the idea, which kind of contradicts the fact that he ran into there with that plan. So what the hell was he planning to do? Like, he just improvised that? That's rather lucky. But whatever. He let's hope that he didn't, and that was just the way it was framed for the audience. But, like, because that makes no sense otherwise. But anyway, I thought he was going to, like, stab her with it, which would have been way too hardcore. Subaru doesn't do stuff like that. So that was... But in my head, I was like, oh, he's going to stab her with it.
I wish something like that would happen.
Yeah, I also thought it was odd that she didn't really know what it was. I found that kind of, because I figured that those were like standard things in their world.
When he was sort of spelling it out for her very clearly, I was expecting her to be like, like, you know, oh shit kind of expression, but no.
Yeah. So yeah, I thought that was kind of odd, but whatever. She got torn to shreds. That's cool, I guess.
I mean, we don't really know what exactly this whole like Beetlejuice thing, like, is this like a... I'm assuming, are all the other sins like this thing?
I have no idea. I mean, no, because the whale was one of them, right?
Oh, you're right. Yeah. And in that aspect...
Yeah, and the whale could divide itself, but it seemed like one of them was real, the others were like...
And that was more of like an animal.
Well, it was a beast thing, yeah. But it's unclear whether it was just inhabiting a whale. I don't think it was. I think it was the whale. And then, as we've already alluded to, you know, Beetlejuice takes him over, and going back to the self-harm thing, when he just allows his cheek to be cut along Julius's sword, that was kind of a nice touch.
That was cool, yeah. And also, just to preface, we're saying Beetlejuice because...
I'm saying Beetlejuice because that's what they say. I mean, they're probably trying to say Beetlejuice.
We're not saying
Beetlegeist
or anything. We're just going to say it like how they're saying it in the show, just as a preface, yeah.
And so he gets taken over, and so the one thing I was just wondering is, when did this happen? How did it happen? Did it happen when the woman was torn up by the beast? Did it happen when they tried to kill him in the previous episode and he exploded? Had it been there for a while? Because remember that they had suspected that he was a sin priest because of how much he smelled like the witch, but that's probably just a coincidence.
Right.
Was he able to be taken over because of this strong spirit affinity? Like, are the sin priest spirits, and because he has this strong sort of spirit affinity, it was easy for him to be taken over? Because we haven't seen anyone else get taken over that we're aware of yet. Now, that they did establish that when we saw Beetlejuice earlier, that was some vessel that he had taken over, as you described before, but we haven't been worried up to this point that just random of the main characters could be people who are taken over. So that's a new concern that they've opened up.
I was kind of hoping, and just to go back to the previous episode, I was sort of thinking, like, well, you know, Subaru could pretend to be one of the, like, allies of these, of, like, Beetlegeist, and maybe destroy the cult from inside, you know. But now that if he has to, like, give up maybe his body and be willingly, like, possessed, then that maybe would explain why that wouldn't have been a good plan anyway, because then he would have
I wasn't thinking about possession. I just thought he was gonna have it like, I have a book and, like, I smell like the witch, I'm a sin priest. I thought it was gonna be something, but that's too dumb, because especially if they're inhabited by spirits, they'd be able to tell he wasn't.
Yeah.
The other concern I have sorry, the other concern I had was if Subaru does die at the end the way that they seem to be implying, you know, although it was weird, like, Fellas, like, touched his head, and then they're all acting like, you know, he's going to die from her touching his head, so maybe
remember
she did
she said
evil.
Her hands can do, terrible things, yeah.
Yes, but it's not, I guess it's not instantaneous, so she's poisoned him or something, or making him die, some sort of damage over time, you know, she put a dot on him.
Yeah.
But then Julius then goes to, you know, slash him, and it's like, well, then why is he, what, are they both gonna kill him to, like, spread the blame around? It's like in a firing squad where only one of them has the live round.
Well, yeah, didn't Julius had a thought before he, like, goes to do that, where he's like, I can't just let, you know...
Yeah, I guess. But I thought that was him reflecting on feeling guilty that this had happened at all.
Well, that too, I think, yeah.
So, if he is dead, when will he come back? You know, when did he last save? hopefully soon, because, you know, it might be annoying otherwise.
Like, I used to like this whole, like, convention thing, but now that it's, like, happening again, it's like, God damn it. Like, where are we going to end up now? Because every time he goes back, it's always a big chunk of the plot,
yeah,
like, that happened. It's, like, a big penalty when he dies. So, I just hope he's not dead. And that we can just continue.
I think he isn't. Because they cliffhangered it and didn't show him dying. Because we've seen him die tons. So him dying isn't really, you know, it isn't like with most shows where it's like, oh no, is the main character going to die? No. In this, maybe. But I think maybe he isn't dead. I think maybe there's some way that they're going to save him in this timeline, or however you want to think about it.
And let's be real here, this is a magical fantasy anime world. There's got to be some way they could get Beetlejuice out of his body, like some silly, like, or whatever, like, magical thing. Like, there's something that maybe they could do so that they can just continue the story, you know. There's all sorts of weird things. Okay, I just want to add though that Wilhelm is fucking awesome.
Yeah, Wilhelm just killing everybody.
And I find it funny that he kind of just basically did an attack that he's done before. The guy, like, blew up, whatever. And he only has, like, a little bit of, like, soot and dirt
on his
face.
He's, like, slightly dirty, and he's on the ground. He's like,
he's not even bleeding.
He needs a phoenix down. He'll be fine.
But it just made me think, like, you know, when Emilia shows up and she's fighting, you know, the Beetlejuice guy who is, like, calling her the witch and, like, having a crush on her. She takes her about 3 or 4 attacks. Seemingly, one of them didn't seem effective at all. Like, she didn't even hit him. Another time, he's, like, dodging it. And then there was the time where she, like, trapped him. And he still, you know, seemed like he wasn't really hit that much. And I just can't help but think all of her magic shit with Puck seems a lot more ineffective than Wilhelm's sword simply just slicing people in half.
Yeah, her magic seems like she's very... what I'm imagining it is it's reflecting her reluctance to hurt anybody, because it's very shitty. Like, it's like an ice shotgun that almost never hits anybody. And
she's very cordial about it. She's like,
yeah, like, thank
surrender
you for being
now,
defeated.
Villain. Yeah, thank you for being defeated.
Yeah, it's... I don't know. I find it personally kind of annoying. I don't like her very much, though. I find her very annoying. I don't really like her as a character very much.
Now, granted, I think, like, Emilia is cute, but, you know, from everything that we've seen with the history of him and Rem, and I'm glad to see most people...
Oh, are we going to get into that?
Well, most people seem to think, you know, that it's like he should be with her, like, given the history that they've had together.
I mean,
so
she's
far.
Also just better. Like, Emilia is nice, she's pretty, she's nice, she's kind, she's powerful.
Nice 2 times.
Whatever. I mean, like, maybe she's the witch, unclear, or somehow linked to the witch. Maybe. But she's, I don't know, she's not... I mean, it seems that Subaru is in love with her, I'm doing air quotes, just because she's pretty and she's nice? Whereas, like, Rem, he and Rem actually have, like, history. Like, she's a real person that he knows. So, like, it makes sense the two of them would have affection for each other. And he does. He refers to when he was talking with, I forget her name, but, like, the other faction leader woman after they defeat the,
The Krush-sama, or
yeah,
whatever,
yeah,
they
her.
Say.
You know,
yeah.
He talks about he has, like, 2 women in his heart or something. So he does love Rem. He just loves Emilia more, which is really stupid.
I just imagine it's like, you know, she was, I think, the first woman he ever saw in this world, right? Like, I mean, like, as far as plot-wise, like, because he, like, kind of bumped into her.
Oh, Emilia, yeah.
Yeah, and so I think ever since then, he's just had this attraction to her. Yeah, maybe he has a thing for elf women, too, you know?
I mean, it's still stupid. I don't know. Anyway, so that's our discussion of episode 23. Like the video if you like the video. Subscribe if you want to hear us talk more about anime and if you want to watch us play more games. And if you have any thoughts on this episode or the series in general, please leave a comment below. And thanks for listening.
We'll see you next time.